Night, man.
How the gigs going, lady?
Good night.
How the gigs going? With the pet dogs.
How the what go?
How the gigs going?
Irreverent, controversial, eccentric. She collects nicknames and reputations as she continues to revolutionize the music industry and live performance. With recognized artistic genius, she has been on top of the charts ever since she blew up in the music scene back in 2008.
She started playing piano when she was 4 or 5. She started writing songs by the time she was in her early teens.
Despite having a short singing career, she took no time in becoming an artistic powerhouse on her own.
I am the hardest working woman in pop.
In 1 week, we did Just Dance, Poker Face, Love Game. We did boom, 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 like, just magic. It was just clicking, and she's very inspiring, very inspiring.
With over 24 million albums sold and 125 million singles sold worldwide, she has made the entire planet go gaga for her.
Everywhere I go in the world, there are Lady Gaga fans. Lady Gaga fans possess a certain quality. I can't quite explain it. Perhaps it's a pop cultural nerve.
From her beginnings as a Catholic schoolgirl to the glittering and provoking musical success, she has had an incredible rise to fame.
Lady Gaga has definitely shaken up the industry. She's just not a cookie cutter pop artist. She just does anything and everything to get people's attention.
Know her secrets, know her story, explore her art. We invite you to discover the artist, the activist, and the genius that is Lady Gaga, the true artist in music. She is an artist out of this world. And in 2015, she will literally be out of this planet. Lady Gaga will be the first artist to perform live from space. She is the headline act of the much-anticipated music and arts festival, Zero G Colony.
I definitely think this will be something successful. It definitely shows that Lady Gaga is a pioneer. She's gonna be one of the first artists, if not the first artist, going out into space to perform music. I think it's going to show her influence not only on music, but on pop culture.
The event is gathering massive support, and if it happens, it will be a historical moment for humanity. And Gaga is making sure her name and art will live on in human history. She's not only a singer-songwriter, Gaga is a respected philanthropist, writer, fashion icon, and LGBT activist.
She is just an absolute gay icon in every way. I remember when she first came along, a friend of mine who runs a very influential gay club in London said, "You've got this all wrong. She's incredible. Look at the way she dresses. Look at how in control she is of her career." And I just didn't get it for a while. I just didn't agree at all. But I think it's her strength. You know, the fact that she does what she wants, that's always very appealing. Anyone who can have that close relationship, you know, with the gay community, in the sense that she's always respected the gay community and played a lot of gay clubs. And she talks very openly about how much she appreciates her gay fan base.
Since her big break, Gaga's appeal has spread to a wider range of music lovers.
When she was first trying to promote her album, Fame, it was very difficult for her. The mainstream American media didn't want to hear about it. They didn't want to know about her. She was just some kind of crazed lunatic who wore a leotard and weird thing on her head. And, you know, her songs were about sex and, you know, and bisexuality, which is, you know, is the thing which the mainstream American media is not very comfortable with ever. And Akon really, you know, he's huge in America. He's got a huge fan base, hip-hop fan base, but his fan base really embraced Gaga, which is one of the incredible things about her. You know, she was going to do that tour with Kanye West. It really kind of brought, amalgamated different demographics of music audience in America.
With big hits like Just Dance, Poker Face, and Bad Romance, she cemented her career and introduced a new style of artist the world wasn't used to. In her performances, she portrays her major influences, such as David Bowie, Andy Warhol, Queen, and Elton John. She became the ultimate artist, a true creative chameleon. Not happy with her musical success, she created her creative hub, inspired by Andy Warhol's The Factory, House of Gaga. They have been the creative team behind her performances, costumes, and music videos since their creation in 2008.
She pushes everything to its extreme, whether it's, you know, dripping with blood in a live performance or whether it's her quite openness about bisexuality in her videos, in her interviews, whether it's just carrying around a teacup because she wants to see what kind of response she'll get from Jonathan Ross when she goes on Jonathan Ross. She does all these things, and it's all, obviously, it's very, very planned, and it's meticulously planned to gain a kind of response, and she's just so clever in that. Another thing which makes her different, I think, as well from other pop acts at the moment is she has this group of advisors around her, stylists and costume makers and so on, who are people who she's been friends with for a long time. And so she has the benefit, I guess, of having people who knew her before who can tell her and bring her down to earth. No, that doesn't work. No, that looks stupid. No, that's what everybody else is doing. Because she needs to keep pushing this innovative edge, and that's what she wants. She wants to be different. She wants to stand out. And so by keeping these people around her who are very loyal and have been, you know, with her for a long time, she manages to do a really good job and not just, you know, take on any old person that the record company wants to throw at her. She keeps people who are loyal. I think that's probably the most important thing.
With genuine vocal abilities, she never shies away from performing live, maintains an incredible vocal range. Stop calling, stop calling. I don't wanna think anymore. I've got my head and my heart on the dance floor. Stop calling. She sings, acts, writes, and is actively trying to change the world. So when did it all begin for Lady Gaga? Where do her roots lie? She was born away from the Hollywood lights and worldwide fame. Stefani Joanne Angelina Germanotta is a born and bred New Yorker.
She grew up Roman Catholic in a strict household. Her parents were actually self-made business people.
But they were immigrants. They were Italian immigrants into the States. And I think when they arrived, you know, when they arrived in America, they didn't have anything. So they had a very, very strong work ethic at home. So she did go to a very good school in New York when she was a teenager. But I don't think she didn't go with the same kind of ethic as lots of the girls that went who were just born into money and expected a lot. She went there thinking that, she was gonna work really hard.
She is the elder daughter of internet entrepreneur Joe Anthony Germanotta Jr. and Cynthia Louise Bissett. With mixed Italian and French roots, Stefani was born into a Catholic household on March 28, 1986.
When she was little, she, you know, a lot of the stuff that she remembers from her parents is them working very, very hard and expecting her and her little sister to work hard too.
Her parents worked 12 hours a day to give Stefani and her sister, Natalie, a good life. Being a Catholic family, Stefani attended the Convent of the Sacred Heart, a private all-girls school in Manhattan. During school years, her life was dedicated to study and discipline. However, she never fit in.
Lady Gaga has said that she's felt like a freak just because growing up, a lot of the kids would tease her because of her big nose and she was a bit chubby.
Lady Gaga, or Stephanie as she was known at the time, was not a student who fit in well with her peers. I think part of the appeal of Lady Gaga now is the fact that she really resonates with a lot of her fans, her little monsters, as she calls them, who may not fit into mainstream, particularly high school society, the way she failed to do.
Well, having gone to a Catholic school myself, I know how strict it is, and I'm sure that for Stephanie, it must have been grueling to be at the school. She not only felt left out, but she also had a very, like, she was a very disciplined student, and I think that came mostly because of her parents. You know, they were very hardworking business people.
Lady Gaga was actually a very serious student who took her grades quite seriously, was very bright in the classroom, and even performed in high school musicals playing like Adelaide in Guys and Dolls. It's very hard to imagine her in such a conventional role. However, she was very focused from an early age on performing.
She had a lot of energy as a small child, and I think her mother, you know, wanted to, as all mothers would, I'm sure, wanted her to direct that into something constructive. So when she first started playing the piano, she didn't actually play at all. Her mother was like, you're gonna sit at that piano. I don't care if you play. You're gonna sit there for an hour every day, just, you know, just to try and control her daughter a little bit. So to start with, I think for the first couple of weeks, she didn't, you know, she didn't do anything. She says she sat there, she crossed her arms, she threw a fit. She said, I'm not going to do, you know, you told me to play piano, I'm not going to play. But eventually, after a while, she knew she had to sit there for an hour every day. She got bored and she started playing. And that's how she got to be as amazing as, you know, piano songwriting as she is today.
When she was 13 years old and already in school, Stefani wrote her first piano ballad and started to perform at open mic sessions.
And this is, you know, that's an incredible leap for somebody, for a child so young. By the time she was in her early teens, she'd already had hundreds, maybe thousands, probably thousands actually, of hours of practice, having to practice every day. The way that she was eventually kind of encouraged to start writing her own songs, but she was in a boutique in New York after school one day, just wandering around, singing along to herself, to whatever music was on the radio. And the guy who was working in this boutique heard her singing and thought she had a fantastic voice and said, oh, you should hook up with my uncle. He's a voice tutor in New York. It was just a completely random occurrence that just happened out of nowhere. And she was a little bit, you know, a bit scared at first, but she took the card and she went home and she made the call. And the voice tutor, the uncle of this random guy who happened to work in this boutique, was Don Lawrence, who is one of the most revered and the most famous vocal coaches in the entire world. He's coached Mick Jagger, he's coached Christina Aguilera, he's coached just hundreds of people. You name almost any of the greats and he will have coached them at some point. And he obviously must have been very impressed with her, because you can imagine how busy his schedule was, but he found time to take her on. And one of the first bits of advice he had for her was, as well as, you know, it's all very well to play the piano, it's all very well to sing, but you need to start developing and start writing your own songs. And that was why she started writing her own songs in the first place.
As a teenager, she appeared in a small role in the hit TV show The Sopranos in 2001 and auditioned without success to many shows in New York. It seemed that Stefani had found her escape, and performing was starting to become her most likely career path. Her mother recognized Stefani's potential and talent towards the arts and encouraged her to apply for the Collaborative Arts Project 21, a musical theater training group at New York's Tisch School of the Arts. She gained early admission at age 17 and started to live in an NYU dorm. She wrote songs and composed essays and analytical papers on art and social issues to improve her writing skills. Her future seemed to be leaning towards a musical and artistic education. However, Stefani felt that it wasn't her path, and only 2 years after being accepted in Tisch School at the age of 19, she decided to drop out to pursue a musical career.
Lady Gaga was just one of 20 people in the world chosen to be part of the school. Even though she quit, it really helped her become who she is today. She actually had 3 jobs at the time to be able to afford all her personal expenses. One of them was actually performing as a burlesque type of go-go dancer. She was performing with one of her good friends, and they would do all sorts of crazy acts. I think they even threw flame up in the air at one point. And I think all those kind of over-the-top performances are obviously what you can see today in her performances. She's wearing meat outfits and all sorts of outrageous things.
I think her parents have finally come to accept her for the person that she is, but I think they have had quite a tough time of coming to terms with it, as I'm sure any parents coming to terms with their kids growing up, it must be quite a difficult thing. But when Gaga was in her teens, I think she would have been in her late teens, kind of 16, 17, she was at Tisch School of the Arts, which is a college for performing arts in New York. She gained entry a year early. She's prodigious talent, really incredible. She's one of, you know, only a handful of people in the world to have gained entry to this school a year early. So she went there, but it wasn't really for her, so she made a deal with her parents. I don't think a deal that they were very happy with, but a deal nonetheless, which was that she was going to drop out of school, drop out of university. She was going to try and make it in the music business on her own terms. And her father said, okay, you have 1 year to get signed. If you don't get signed, you're going back to university. I think obviously he was very, you know, he was very scared that she wasn't going to go back, and having a college education is very, very important to him. You know, he really wanted, you know, the best for his kids, and he wasn't going to raise 2 daughters who were just going to live off their parents' money. He wanted those girls to have their own careers and make their own money.
By her own admission, she got the cheapest apartment she could and ate badly. She wasted no time and recorded a couple of songs with hip-hop singer Grandmaster Melle Mel for an audiobook. She teamed up with some colleagues from Tisch School and formed the Stefani Germanotta Band, the SG Band. They played in some bars in New York and developed a small fan base. This didn't go unnoticed by music producer Joe Vulpes, who invited the band to his studio to record their extended plays, Words and Red and Blue, both released in 2005. They kept performing gigs in New York and reached their peak when they were invited to perform at the 2006 Songwriters Hall of Fame New Songwriters Showcase at the Cutting Room.
The rock music scene in New York really helped her influence her. I mean, if you see how she dresses today, she has a lot of influences of rock glam, going back to David Bowie and, you know, a lot of these rock artists from the 70s. Like I said before, she, you know, did a little bit of burlesque, so she really wasn't afraid of showing more or doing more to get attention from people. Surprisingly, the band did really well in New York. They did all sorts of gigs throughout the city. The band actually reached its peak when they performed at the Songwriters Hall of Fame in 2006. And eventually, that led to Lady Gaga being discovered by Rob Fusari.
During this performance, The group was spotted by a talent scout for music producer Rob Fasari. Fasari contacted Stefani and invited her to work with him. After this, the SG band disbanded, and Stefani would travel daily to New Jersey to work on songs she had written and composed with Fasari.
Signing with Rob Fasari was a big deal for Lady Gaga. It really set the work environment that she had later on in other years. She was not only traveling almost on a daily basis to New Jersey to shell out songs with him and whatnot, but eventually they became boyfriend and girlfriend. And so Rob, through his relationship to Lady Gaga, actually gave her the name of Lady Gaga.
And when they first started working together, she wanted to make a very grungy, very rock-heavy record. She's very into that kind of scene, which is why, you know, guitar riffs and that big sound, they still feature strongly in her music now, which is a great thing. She brings in lots of different influences from lots of different kinds of music. Rob Fasari was incredibly important in Gaga's life. Obviously, it may have gone sour now. We don't know what's happened. Exactly, but he was pivotal. He's a producer who's had so much experience already in the kind of sphere that Gaga wanted to move into, which is kind of, you know, mainstream world pop domination. Look at Destiny's Child, look at Beyonce. She's, you know, she rules. She absolutely rules the pop charts now. And Fasari had been writing songs, you know, for a very long time. He was very experienced, which was something that, you know, that was something that Gaga didn't have. She was entering this industry kind of completely, you know, like as a virgin. She had no real experience. She didn't know anybody in the industry. And, you know, 9 times out of 10, that's how you get somewhere, is by knowing somebody. And she didn't know anybody. She went in cold and she made all her contacts on the way. She didn't use, you know, even though her parents didn't really have contact, she didn't use the fact that her parents were well off to kind of buy herself a record deal. She worked really, really hard.
The music producer compared Stefani's vocal harmonies with Queen's leading man, Freddie Mercury. Every time she would come into the studio, Fasari would play Queen's song, Radio Gaga.
Her stage name, Lady Gaga, came from her first producer, the first producer that she worked with, Rob Fasari. They were messing around together in the studio, and he was always just laughing at her, saying that she was incredibly theatrical. She used to play the piano and throw her head back and kick her legs up in the air and stand up. It's a trick that she still does now, actually, stand up on the stool and bend down, play the piano from standing up. And he would always just laugh at how theatrical she was, because he just thought it was ridiculous and very funny, which it is. It's a, you know, it's a great thing. It's a performance. She's just playing the piano, but she's doing so much as well as playing the piano.
And one time he went to text her something about Radio Gaga, and the predictive text changed radio to Lady. So it came out Lady Gaga, and she wrote back in text and said, "That's it. Never call me Stefani again." So according to them, that is how the name was born. It's a tribute to the Queen song, which was a big favorite of hers. And ever since then, you know, she has not looked back.
And she even complains now about when interviewers are trying to be a bit pally and they call her Stefani. And she says, you know, "You don't know me, that's not my name. Everybody calls me Gaga. And if you don't call me Gaga, you're not respecting me as a person, because nobody calls me. Nobody calls me that. Everyone calls me Gaga."
Really suits the persona that Lady Gaga has become. You know, she's never out of character. A friend of mine did a yoga class with her in New York City, and she arrived in full makeup, in 12-inch platform shoes, with red lipstick, a wig. You know, she, even for a Bikram yoga class where you are sweating, and she had the false eyelashes, you know, sliding down her face, she is so committed to the character. She does not step out of that character ever.
This collaboration was fruitless at the start, but the producer and the singer were a strong combination, and they set up a company called Team Lovechild. They recorded electro-pop tracks and sent them to music industry moguls.
Rob Fossari took her to the first couple of meetings that she had with record labels when they were trying to shop around, trying to find her a record deal. So he took her to Def Jam, and she went to some other records, some other record labels as well, when they were working together. They'd written songs together. They put some songs down on CD. He took her to these record labels, and, you know, these are quite important meetings with people who are, you know, pretty high up in big record labels. This would have been something that, on her own, she might not have been able to do. They would have just been like, who are you? You're just, you know, another one of the hundreds and hundreds of singer-songwriters that there are in New York. What makes you any different? Because he already had experience, because he already had contacts, he was able to take her in, you know, show them a CD, say, this is a girl you really need to listen to. So when he took her to, Def Jam, they didn't, L.A. Reid is the chairman of Def Jam, and he wasn't in the room when Gaga was being auditioned or when she went in and sang for them. But he says that it must have been like they have telepathic powers in that building, because she started singing and someone must have sent out some kind of message to L.A. Reid saying, there's something in this room you really need to hear. And, you know, a minute later he appeared in the room, and as they were leaving, he said, you know, you need to sign on the way out, go down to legal, sign the contract. They didn't sign the contract then and there. I think they went away and saw some other labels, but then they did come back and they did eventually sign her to Def Jam.
This was a huge impact in her career. It was her big break and probably her first opportunity to get into the mainstream media.
In September 2006, she signed a deal with the label with the intention of releasing an album in 9 months. However, she was dropped after only 3 months.
So she was signed to them for 3 or 4 months. It was really exciting. Her dad had given her this deal saying that you have to be signed within a year. I'm going to let you drop out of university. You've got to be signed within a year. And she was. She got this deal with Def Jam. But it went, they had kind of had 2 or 3 months. She kept calling the label, trying to arrange meetings with L.A. Reid. They didn't want to see her. Both Rob Fossari and Gaga to this day say they don't know what happened with the label. There was just some kind of breakdown. Perhaps they didn't know how to market her. They didn't know what to do with her, because she was very different from all the other singer-songwriters that came in. So something happened. She didn't get much time anyway with Def Jam, and after 3 or 4 months, they dropped her.
This was a huge setback for Lady Gaga. I mean, she was devastated by the fact that only after 3 months she was dropped by this label. She had to go back and be comforted by her family.
And she was absolutely distraught, completely distraught. Rob Fossari was on a plane from New York to San Francisco, and during that flight, she found out she was dropped, and she made, you know, 30 phone calls to him, just completely hysterical, saying, they dropped me, I don't know what I'm gonna do. And, you know, this was her dream. She thought she was there.
At that time, she kind of lost her way a little bit. You know, she admits she tried a lot of drugs at that time. She was a burlesque dancer, which is kind of a fancy word for a stripper in some ways, you know, in kind of the heart of New York City. And she was, you know, really getting kind of close to the dark side of fame.
She started doing burlesque routines, doing go-go dancing in clubs, but it was kind of like a variety performance. It was a fun thing, quite risque. And she was go-go dancing with a friend of hers from New York called Lady Starlight, who was 10 years older than her, but a big mentor, a big factor in Gaga's life. And she's a rock and roll DJ, and she was also go-go dancing. And the pair of them would go to rock clubs and wear very little. And by very little, I mean, you know, leopard print thong, perhaps a bra covered in mirrors, which they'd stuck on, you know, like a $3 bra, and some little mirrors, tiled mirrors, which they stuck on with glue. She invited her parents to come and watch her during one of these performances, and the first time they ever saw her perform, she was wearing a thong and she was wearing a bra, and she was lighting cans of hairspray on fire on stage and throwing around a beach ball that was covered with tiny tiled mirrors. And her father just, he held it together while he was there, but he got home and she wasn't there, but he completely just fell to pieces and just said, I don't know what on earth she's doing. She's lost the plot.
Her father, Joe, could not understand her drug abuse, and couldn't look at her for several months. It was a rough period in her life. But it was during this moment that Gaga would finally find her freedom and her art. The pair performed a show called Lady Gaga and the Starlight Review, a tribute to 70s variety acts. They started performing the songs Gaga and Fusari had worked on and were soon invited to perform at the Lollapalooza Festival in August 2007.
At the time she played Lollapalooza, she was booked to play with Lady Starlight. So it was Lady Gaga and the Starlight Review. So they played together. Gaga would play on stage on her keyboard and she would sing. And the two of them together would go-go dance. So they would do, you know, kind of the stuff with setting hairspray on fire, kind of shaking their asses at the crowd. Fun stuff, you know, enjoyable stuff. Lollapalooza is a rock festival, a straight-up rock festival. And you can imagine how, you know, how bemused everyone there would have been to just be like, what the hell, there's two girls. They went on stage in dresses and stripped off through the routine. So by the time they came off stage, they went from being pretty much fully dressed to just having pants and bra covered in mirror balls, which is fabulous, but not obviously what a rock crowd is expecting. And one of the things that Gaga says was her favourite thing about that performance was the looks on the audience's face, just staring and just being like, we just watched Sonic Youth and now is these two crazy girls setting things on fire and just wearing nothing.
Their performance was acclaimed and Gaga had found her musical niche.
It was a bit of a pivotal time because when she was there, all of the paparazzi were chasing her around the whole festival because everyone thought she was Amy Winehouse because she had very long, dark hair. Her natural hair colour is dark brunette. She had bangs, you know, she had this thick fringe, she had long, thick, wavy hair. She's quite petite, so obviously very ill-informed journalists thought she was Amy Winehouse and chasing her around going, Amy, Amy, give us an interview. By the end of it, she decided to dye her hair a different colour because she was so sick of it and she realised if she was going to make it in the pop industry, in the music industry, she needed a look that was entirely hers. And if everyone thought she was Amy Winehouse, then that was obviously no good.
While Gaga was performing with Starlight, Fusari kept working on their songs and eventually sent a demo out to record executive Vincent Herbert. Upon hearing her vocals and style, Herbert was quick to sign her to his label, Streamline Records, an imprint label for Interscope Records. While at Interscope, Lady Gaga would write songs for Britney Spears and label friends New Kids on the Block, Fergie, and the Pussycat Dolls.
This opportunity opened up a lot of doors for her. Obviously, she must have been frustrated because she wasn't performing. She was writing for these big artists like Britney Spears. But eventually, she was able to make a lot of connections, which led her to perhaps being chosen to be the opening act for the Pussycat Dolls World Doll Domination Tour. And it also helped her obtain a relationship with Michael Bolton so that he could help her write songs later in her career.
A pop singer, I would probably be on acid following the Beatles somewhere. I love rock stars, and there's very little left today, but in the 70s they were running rampant, so.
She's always thinking about the next thing she's doing. She's thinking three or four videos ahead. And I knew she was a star, but I didn't know she was going to be the biggest thing in the universe by now.
Rob Fusari was being managed at the time by a talent agency who'd also taken Gaga on. They were managing her as well. And another person who they were managing within this talent company was Red One. And the management thought it would be a good idea to introduce Gaga to Red One.
He calls me, tells me, you know, I want you to meet this artist. I was like, okay, is this girl artist. I was like, is she signed? It was like, no, she just got dropped. I was like, no, please, you know, I really That's it. I told you, I don't want... Well, like, you know what? Okay, just meet her and make a decision after. Just meet her. If you don't like her, I think she's a superstar. Superstar, just meet her. If you don't think so, you don't have to work with her. So I said, you know what? I was like, okay, I'll meet her. So I met her and went to, you know, to the city and da-da-da, I met her. She was like, she had glasses, you know, with glasses and hair, all that. Like, hey, Lady Gaga. Just the way she said hi to me, I was like, okay.
And they met and they hit it off immediately. Red One thought she was incredibly talented, but he offered to work with her for free because he thought, you know, he thought she was so talented, knew she didn't have any money, she wasn't signed, she was just this girl who needed a break, and he knew that together they could make some incredible music. So while they were working together, Akon and Red One also know each other, have a partnership, and Red One said to Akon, you know, you need to meet this girl, she's incredibly talented.
Singer-songwriter Akon recognized Gaga's vocal abilities. He saw her as a star, and not only as a songwriter. He invited her to sing a reference vocal for one of his tracks. This was enough to get him to convince Interscope CEO Jimmy Levine to have a joint deal, which would put Gaga signing with Akon's own label, Con Live. In 2008, Lady Gaga moved to LA to focus on completing her debut album under Con Live and Interscope Records. She set up a creative team called House of Gaga. Her debut album, The Fame, was released in August 2008 to slow radio play. Gaga performed around Europe and in small gay clubs around the US.
When she was first, when she was first trying to promote her album, Fame, it was very difficult for her. The mainstream American media didn't want to hear about it. They didn't want to know about her. She was just some kind of crazed lunatic who wore a leotard and weird thing on her head. And, her songs were about sex and bisexuality, which is, you know, is a thing which the mainstream American media is not very comfortable with ever. And Akon really, you know, he's huge in America. He's got a huge fan base, hip-hop fan base, but his fan base really embraced Gaga, which is one of the incredible things about her. You know, she was going to do that tour with Kanye West. It really kind of amalgamated different demographics of music audience in America.
I love Kanye. Kanye is my very dear friend, and we are creative kindreds. It's been fun to work on the design of the tour with him as we're finishing each other's sentences. It's going to be one of the most groundbreaking moments in touring history. I am sure of it.
The album achieved moderate success. However, another track had been previously released 4 months before the album. The track was the sleeper hit, Just Dance, a collaboration with Colby O'Donis. However, it only hit its peak in January 2009, provoking instant success of the album.
Well, the song was definitely a hit. It was a little bit lower budgeted, I would say, than some of her later videos. It was very simple. It was just her at a house party. Akon and Colby O'Donis appeared in the video. Colby was one of Akon's proteges, I guess. And you actually get to see her face a little bit more, which nowadays you really don't get to because she's wearing all sorts of, you know, masks and these outrageous costumes. But there were some signature things about her wardrobe that you got to see in these videos, like the leather biker glove or her signature white wig, that straight wig that she had. Obviously, in this video, though, it was a little bit shorter, but later on in her career, you get to see all sorts of variations of that same wig.
Oh,
Like, we wrote Just Dance in 1 hour. Done, you know? And then, of course, the recording, we did the other recording another day after or something, but we were just writing. We recorded the demo in my computer. 1 hour, Poker Face, 1 hour. It's like, it just happened, you know what I mean? Like, magic.
This track would win Gaga her first Grammy Award for Best Dance Recording and became one of the best-selling singles worldwide.
Gaga really did have a meteoric rise. You know, a lot of times people become famous overnight after they've worked for years and years and years. Gaga's journey was relatively short. She went from obscurity to overnight international number one fame with her album The Fame, ironically perhaps titled. But it really did put her on the map, and she ended up winning Grammys. She won Best Album of the Year, and she became really an overnight household name. You know, the pressure that goes with that, you know, she's talked about it in her songs like Paparazzi, where she's like literally murdered on stage when she sings that song that's part of the act. But there's no question that it would have been difficult for her to deal with, you know, the adjustment of going from being a normal person, somewhat normal person, to being a superstar so quickly.
But another track of the album would achieve even greater success. Poker Face.
The video and the song were a smash hit. In the video, you get to see her coming out of a pool wearing a mask made out of all these bits of shattered glass.
The video was heavily stylized and was used to set up the image that Gaga would explore in her future work. Thanks to these two tracks, the album was lauded by the critics and was a huge, unexpected success. It stayed atop of the dance electronic charts for 106 non-consecutive weeks.
Oh my goodness, I'm so honored, and I'm grateful, and I just can't believe everything that's happened. And it's really been a remarkable year, and Billboard has been so supportive. So.
She also won MTV VMA's Best New Artist with the video for her single, Paparazzi. Lady Gaga introduced herself to the world in the most unusual way, with two sleeper hits that propelled her career. She gained a huge fan base all over the globe, and more prominently in Europe, where her records always achieved greater success. She spent some time writing new material for an EP containing 8 songs that explored the dark side of fame. The EP was called The Fame Monster, and made Gaga the first artist in digital history to have 3 singles to pass 4 million digital sales.
The album debuted at number 5 in the charts, selling at least 175,000 copies. It had a couple of hit songs like Bad Romance, and unlike her first album, which was called Fame, this one was called The Fame Monster. Fame showed the good side of the industry, The Fame Monster showed the darker side of the industry.
Your album, The Fame, it's just sold its 10 millionth copy in the last few days, and the last album to do that was Back to Black by Amy Winehouse. She has, I suspect, rather struggled to cope with fame. How are you coping with it?
Well, I try very much to ignore it.
The lead single, Bad Romance, topped the charts in 18 different countries.
The Bad Romance video took place in what looked like a bathhouse. It's actually called the Bathhouse of Gaga. And you can obviously tell that her career was on the rise. It was a much higher budgeted video. The costuming was incredible. She had some sort of makeshift crowns, which I guess gave the feeling that she was a queen and she was surrounded by her court. Roma, Roma, Gaga. The video also showed her lover, and at the end, you see the lover, it's actually a burned skeleton on a burned bed, which kind of, I don't know, gave us, it was a, I guess a hint of what was gonna come later on. Like, she had a really kind of dark sense of humor, and this was just one of the first videos where we got to see that.
The second single of this EP was a collaboration with diva Beyoncé. The single, Telephone, was critically acclaimed, and the video was hailed as having the showmanship and musicality of Michael Jackson and the erotic and provocative instincts of Madonna.
Well, it's interesting, the Madonna comparison with Lady Gaga, because it came along very early in her career. And it seemed like quite a bold claim at that stage. But as her career's developed and her singles have come out and she's had a much larger public profile, it's very obvious that she's very in control of her career, her look, her sound. And obviously that has parallels with Madonna. But she does something very different from Madonna as well, I think. So in a sense, you can see that she is like the Madonna of old, but also she's completely her own person. She's completely unique.
Madonna is a huge influence on her, yeah, definitely. And Cyndi Lauper as well. She models herself very, very much on these strong female icons. Madonna especially, because Madonna was, you know, such a big influence in the 80s, when 80s and early 90s, when Gaga was growing up. And Madonna being such a chameleon, well, I say chameleon, but actually by Gaga standards, she wasn't at all, because, you know, Madonna would go through an image change maybe once every 2 years and everyone would be like, oh my God, she's changed her image, she's a goth now, or oh my God, she's got her boobs out, or oh my God, she's got blonde hair and something, or she's, you know, she's Evita now. Whereas now, Gaga changes her image like within the space of a flight from LA to Australia. You know, she goes on at LAX and she has her short blonde wig and she has glasses on. She comes out the other end and she has fangs and long purple hair and she has boots with human hair coming off the back. And, you know, she just has taken all of these things which have influenced her, Madonna especially, Madonna is a huge influence, taken these ideas of being kind of like a social chameleon, of changing your armour to disguise yourself or to stand out more, but she's taken it to such an extreme. It's insane.
I think it was intriguing when Gaga duetted with Beyoncé. I mean, very different musical styles, very different voices, and yet they came together on a great song. I think it was intriguing that Beyoncé wanted to do that. I mean, obviously, it goes to show that Gaga, who's a new kid in town, has some street cred if Beyoncé wants to record with you. I can't think of a lot of other artists Beyoncé's done that with, obviously her husband Jay-Z, but it was a big compliment, I think, to Gaga that Beyoncé wanted to sing with her, who's, you know, she's kind of a legend. I think for Lady Gaga, you know, it was good for her too, because Beyoncé's obviously more mainstream than she is, and it really kind of cemented her in the mainstream pop world.
Lady Gaga was set for international fame and fortune. She collected award after award after award, and her rise would not stop there.
Well, I was signed to Interscope over 2 years ago, and I got to know Jimmy and Dr. Dre, and I was really excited because I heard about this project that they were doing, Beats by Dre, and I loved the idea of creating a headphone that sonically made it possible for fans to listen to music the way that producers and artists intended for them to hear it. So this made me just so inspired. So I said to myself, I wonder if I could work with them.
And Jimmy and I talked about it, and Joy and I talked about it. And I said, what if we did a new headphone and we called it Heartbeats?
She would create an image of a true visionary artist and paired up with fashion photographer Stephen Klein, and together they made the video for the single Alejandro. The reactions to the video were strong and came from different places. The Catholic League accused Gaga of overusing blasphemy. Despite all the controversy that her videos generated, they made her the first artist to achieve 1 billion views on YouTube. She got 8 awards out of 13 nominations at the 2010 MTV VMAs. She had the entire planet at her command. But this was not enough for Lady Gaga. In 2011, a new era for Lady Gaga would begin. Already hailed as superstar, Lady Gaga's rise would continue. She released her second studio album, Born This Way, with Akon stating that she was taking her music to the next level.
I'm just celebrating 2 Grammys for Gaga. I'm happy. You know, I watched her work so hard to get to this point, so I'm excited. T-Pain won some Grammys as well. So I'm good.
He really took her under his wing. He took her, they went and did interviews together, they performed together, they toured together. This was way before she had anything approaching the level of stage show she has now. So it was her and two female dancers on a stage. And the biggest prop they had was a disco stick, which was this, you know, stick that she had, this kind of staff that lit up. And that was the show, that was her, you know, that was the whole thing. But even from back then, when from such humble beginnings, Akon just knew that she was, you know, he's really great at spotting talent and bringing it through. And he's said since then that, you know, Lady Gaga's amazing success means he can just retire. He doesn't have to do anything else again in the rest of his life.
This album spawned hit after hit, with the singles Born This Way and Judas hitting the top of the charts worldwide.
This album is my baby. I spent over a year and a half, almost 2 years, writing it. And I wrote it while on tour, on the Monster Ball tour. So I was inspired by each and every city that I went to and the fans from each and every city. The album is about being yourself and loving who you are and being proud, and that in life you can be reborn over and over again until you find that part of you that represents you the best.
Another hit from this album was The Edge of Glory. The video for this track had a completely different style and tone from her previous work, and it showed the incredible artistic view from her House of Gaga team.
The song debuted at number 31 on the Billboard Hot 100, and the video showed her kind of like in a New York City brownstone neighborhood. She was wearing a 2-piece suit with a couple of gold studs on it, very, very glamorous, let's say. And it was a little bit more somber than her other videos. A lot of jazz influences. You could hear the saxophone in the video and in the song as well. And she's just pretty much by herself dancing in the street on the edge of New York City, what looks like a New York City fire escape balcony.
I really, really love what I do. I genuinely live and breathe and love music and my art, and I'm a very passionate person. And I guess when you feel as though you would be empty without your work, you don't mind the hustle and you don't mind stopping.
She appeared on several TV shows like Saturday Night Live and even The Simpsons, imitating Marilyn Monroe, as Gaga performed at the 65th birthday celebrations of former U.S. President Bill Clinton. She also launched the Born This Way Ball Tour, which caused controversy amongst religious Islamic groups, and after violent threats, Gaga and her team had to cancel the Indonesia leg of the tour, even though 52,000 tickets had been sold out in days.
I find it so important to be now a role model and a figure. And I know that that might sound strange to some people who say, oh, but she's so, you know, her clothing and whatever people may think of me. I know what some people may think of me, but most importantly is my connection with my fans.
The tour went ahead. However, in February 2013, Lady Gaga had suffered a tear in her hip, which caused her to cancel the tour. Despite her injury, she kept on working on her new album. She claimed the album would make audiences have a really good time. She stated the work was planned to mimic a good night out at a club. In August 2013, Lady Gaga introduced the lead single for her album, Art Pop. She performed the single Applause at the 2013 MTV VMAs.
Lady Gaga's performance of Art Pop at the VMAs wasn't as big as everyone thought it was gonna be. Not only because Miley Cyrus stole the show that year by twerking and sticking out her tongue, but Katy Perry also stole the show because there was so much publicity around her album versus Lady Gaga's. The performance was pretty much a reenactment of the music video of Art Pop. And unfortunately for Lady Gaga, there were a couple of people booing her during her performance. The one thing that I will give to her is that, I mean, the dancers just did an incredible job of literally changing her on the spot on stage and just changing her outfit. It was a beautiful performance, but I don't think it got the attention that she expected it to.
The single made an immediate impact with critics, hailing the single's artistry and depth.
I think Applause is a wonderful song. It's a little bit different from Lady Gaga's other songs, which have a bit more of an upbeat dance club tempo to it. I think fans were expecting her to be a little bit more over the top. And the video was actually a reflection of that as well. It wasn't as over the top as some of the other stuff she'd done, such as the Bad Romance video. I'd say it's definitely way more artistic. You not only see the influence that she's had on other artists, but you see the influence that other artists have had on her. She's been collaborating throughout the promotion of Art Pop with designers and doing all sorts of stuff that may seem a little bit more underground than more mainstream. You don't see her on a lot of magazine covers, doing as much publicity as she's done for previous albums.
In October of 2013, Lady Gaga would star in Robert Rodriguez's film Machete Kills as La Chameleon. The movie was poorly received both commercially and critically. It failed to impress audiences.
I think this is definitely a transition for Lady Gaga. I mean, she's no stranger to the stage. She did go to NYU for performing arts. But maybe, you know, the fact that Art Pop wasn't as big as she expected it to be, she's taking advantage of the fact that she can extend her 15 seconds of fame and perhaps do a little of acting and star in movies, much like other people such as Diana Ross or Beyoncé have done.
She's not only a successful musician and fashion designer, but she's also known for fighting against sexual discrimination and actively supports the LGBT cause.
She's very encouraging and supportive of the gay community, and she's been very, very encouraging of gay teenagers, you know, to be strong and be themselves, and, you know, doesn't really matter if you're gay, who you are is a beautiful thing. And that's one of the reasons that, you know, she's just so incredible.
Well, I believe very much in charity and in fighting for good causes. I went to Catholic school growing up and we did lots of community service. So it's something that I really enjoy doing.
She's outspoken about her bisexuality and defends the end of discrimination actively, participating in gay pride parades and conventions, making speeches about it, and using her influence to cause positive changes.
This is not just about a party. It is not just a peaceful demonstration. It is a spirit of a basic human right. We are here today to defend love. I'm often questioned why so much gay speak. I am often questioned, how gay are you, Lady Gaga? Why is this question? Why is this issue so important? My answer is, I am a child of diversity. I am one with my generation. I feel a moral obligation as a woman or a man to exercise my revolutionary potential and make the world a better place.
Gay fans really gave Gaga her career more than anyone else. When she was a struggling New York City kind of wacky artist, it was her gay fan base that really pushed her forward. And it's not just an assumption. I mean, it's really true. In fact, there was a gay and lesbian like record label that actually was instrumental in getting her signed initially. They really embraced her from the very beginning. Now, bearing in mind, the people that Gaga was performing in front of in those early years were probably very much gay, part of the gay scene in New York. It was downtown New York, around 11th Street. It was at nightclubs late at night, and there was a big gay scene there. And they were her earliest and most ferocious fans. It's to Gaga's credit that she hasn't forgotten about them. Born This Way seems to be a very obvious statement to her gay fans. In fact, that they are born this way. And I think that she has never missed an opportunity to speak out in support of equality, equal rights for gays and lesbians. And, you know, in fact, Gaga has kind of put her money where her mouth is.
All of this made Lady Gaga a phenomenal star, and she has conquered the world. Despite her first acting experience being a letdown for audiences, she will keep pursuing this side of her art. She has already been confirmed as a cameo appearance in another Robert Rodriguez film, this time the sequel of Sin City. Sin City, A Dame to Kill For, starring opposite Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Bruce Willis, Mickey Rourke, Josh Brolin, and Jessica Alba.
I definitely think this is a way for Lady Gaga to extend her career and to become, you know, a triple threat, I guess. She knows that album sales are on the decline, so she has to look for other ways to make money. It wouldn't surprise me if Lady Gaga not only became a movie star, but perhaps made a venture into reality TV and ends up judging one of many singing reality competitions.
Musically, she's preparing another album. This time, a completely different style. Having had her audience embrace her Europop style sound, she will team up with jazz legend Tony Bennett in a jazz album called Cheek to Cheek.
Well, being that Lady Gaga actually knows how to play the piano, I not only expect something really classy from this collaboration, but I expect something perhaps, I don't know, a little bit irreverent. Maybe we'll see Tony Bennett sing something more pop, something definitely fun. I don't think Lady Gaga is going to bore her audience, basically.
Well, I like the way she thinks, and she comes up with a lot of good things and breaks down racial prejudice and You know, she has good things about society and how things should be.
In the jazz album, Gaga's vocal ability will be the center point of the tracks, and she has proven time and time again that she has the ability to pull it off.
I think as a vocalist, she is possibly not the greatest vocalist in the world, but there is a quality to her voice that when she uses it well, I think it really works. You know, in Bad Romance, I love the fact that she can be really bombastic and silly almost with a Romama kind of bits that really just work really well. But also in some of the verses, you can hear different tones to her voice. I think what's really interesting about her is that she hasn't got the greatest voice in the world, but she does have that range. And I'd put her somewhere like, alongside an artist like, say, Beyoncé, who also has a good voice, but not one of the great voices, who can show that colour and shade in her songs.
All of her success, ventures, and art have found their audiences on planet Earth. There's nothing left for her to achieve. She has credibility from her peers, respect from her critics, and undying love from her devoted fans.
I know I could never tell a lie in my life about my fans. I love them more than any artist on the earth loves their fans. I love my fans so much. They're the reason that I'm here. They're the reason that I love to make music.
She has the world at her fingertips. So what is left for Gaga? The question might be tricky to answer. However, Gaga found an answer. In true Gaga style, having found complete success on planet Earth, she's now literally pointing to the stars. In early 2015, Lady Gaga will perform in the first ever concert in space as part of Zero G Colony, a 3-day music festival.
For me, this is like a total dream come true. And it is really not just for me, but because I'm always trying to figure out a way to make my own existence a metaphor for my young fans. And for them, there are many young artists, there are many young minds, and I was just a young artist and a young mind living in New York across the river here, and here I am today.
She will travel via Spaceport America, located in New Mexico, which is the world's first commercial spaceport. The event will be a mixture of entertainment and cutting-edge technology. And Gaga will be the headline act. An ambitious endeavor that will guarantee Lady Gaga's name in the history books. Already part of music history, she wants to engrave her name in human history. And found the perfect way to do it. A star amongst the stars, scintillating high and above, with an incredible view of the planet she will momentarily leave behind. The photographer Terry Richardson started making a documentary about art pop and House of Gaga in 2013.
I expect to see a very intimate look into Lady Gaga's life. Obviously something incredible, over the top, a fly on the wall look into what it's like to come up with all the different stunts that she does on stage at these red carpets and see how much time she actually puts into making those elaborate outfits.
The date of its release is still unknown. However, it has all the right elements to become a successful and controversial documentary. The mother monster has a bright and successful career, and her little monsters will ensure the Gaga's name will live on in the spotlight.
Everywhere I go in the world, there are Lady Gaga fans. Lady Gaga fans possess a certain quality. I can't quite explain it. Perhaps it's a pop cultural nerve. They come in hair bows, covered in glitter, sweating and screaming. Everybody's a little different in each country, but for the most part, there are Lady Gaga fans everywhere.
I think that we share a passion and a love for music and a passion and love for joy through the arts. And I think my fans and I share a wonderful connection here. The bridge of technology with art and commercialism is something that I'm quite obsessed with.
Over the years, she has contributed to various charities and even started her very own Born This Way Foundation. The foundation targets issues like self-confidence, well-being, anti-bullying, and it supports mentoring and career development.
Well, certainly I am a gay rights activist and a social justice activist. We designed these We Pray for Japan bracelets the day the disaster occurred. And we've raised millions of dollars already for tsunami relief. I believe in the power of music to change people's lives, not necessarily my music, but music in general. And I want to do everything that I can to mobilize the youth to be aware of what's going on worldwide and help one another.
I have a simple message this morning. That is to thank Lady Gaga and MTV for all you are doing for Japan here this week.
All in all, Lady Gaga is a name that is recognized everywhere around the world. Her music and controversies reach a wide audience, and her tracks are a constant presence on dance floors the world over. She got her fame and fortune through hard work and never ceased to believe that her freakiness would one day be her calling. The world of music would be a different place without Gaga's taste for pushing boundaries and provoking reactions.
Well, Lady Gaga has definitely shown that the digital era is here and it's not going anywhere. She's been dubbed the queen of downloads. Her videos have been viewed millions of times online. And I think that she shows that in order to make a connection with her audience, she not only has to promote her videos on TV, she really has to make a mark online. People are not going to TV to watch music videos. They can easily go online, look it up on YouTube or any one of these sites, and, you know, look up an artist video. I think it shows that you, in order to sell albums or just to be able to sell out a concert or whatnot, you have to, you know, make that connection online with people. So I think, yeah, she is the queen of the digital era.
You know, she's the queen of music, pop music, in a completely new era. You know, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, when Britney first started out, when Christina Aguilera started out, beginning of Madonna's career, we didn't have downloads, we didn't have MP3s, we didn't have any of this. We're moving into a completely new paradigm for music, generally, not just pop music. And Gaga is proving that, you know, I'm sure there are hundreds of thousands of illegal downloads of her music as well, all of this, the video views, it's translating into money, it's translating into hard cash, into paid for downloads. You know, she's huge, she's making money. It's proof that money can be made in the industry still.
Lady Gaga has definitely shaken up the industry. She's just not a cookie cutter pop artist. She just does anything and everything to get people's attention. And that's why she's been such a big influence on the world of, you know, in the world of music, in the world of pop culture. I think in the future, we'll definitely see her doing other things, you know, besides music. Much like Madonna has done film and so has Beyonce. You know, Lady Gaga has proven that she is not afraid to, you know, do a little bit of acting. She already did a TV special with the Muppets, so, and she's done a couple of films. So maybe, you know, she'll leave music to the side once it gets a little slow for her, if it becomes a little slow for her, and she'll go full time into, you know, becoming an actress, or perhaps just leaving the scene. Maybe she'll surprise us and leave the scene and go into songwriting, which she also has a lot of experience in.
The biggest danger for Lady Gaga is forgetting who Stephanie Germanotta is and that she ever existed. I think Gaga is so committed to the character, the performance, the performer that she is now. I think the biggest danger for her going forward is that she could have some kind of mental break or emotional break, because I don't know who can actually stay in character all the time. I think it would be very easy for her to lose herself in this persona. And I'm not sure that that's good for you. I'm not sure that she could be, you know, that she could sustain that. Hopefully, she has people around her, close to her, who remind her of who she is when she's not Lady Gaga.
With 5 Grammy Awards and 13 MTV Video Music Awards, she is considered one of the world's 100 most powerful women, according to Forbes magazine. Soon to be an artist from the stars, Lady Gaga has given us out-of-this-world performances and music, and she will undoubtedly continue her efforts to provide us with artistic and powerful songs. Lady Gaga is a true visionary, and music is her art.
My mouth.